read through the stem of the question. So this says that you have a function that is twice differentiable. So these words twice differentiable means that the second derivative of the function exists, but if the second derivative exists, it also means that the first derivative exists. But if f is differentiable, then it also means that f is continuous. So there's lots of things that this those words are telling you. Second derivative, first derivative exists, and the function is continuous. It gives you 2 points on the graph f, and then it also defines a different function, g, which is really f of x. So g is a composite function. Okay, first part A says, explain why there has to be a value of c, so that's an x value, between 2 and 5, such that the derivative is equal to negative 1. Okay, now, there's no function that I can take the derivative of. The only thing it tells me about f is that these are the 2 points. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and take the derivative or find the slope between these 2 points. So if I do f of 5 minus f of 2 over 5 minus 2, you get 2 minus 5 over 3, which gives you negative 1. Notice that is what I'm asking you to find. But this is saying the derivative is equal to negative 1, or the slope of the tangent line. But notice what I found here was actually the slope of the secant line. But I can say that there is going to be a place where the tangent line is going to be the same as the slope of the secant line. And the reason is because they're telling us that this is a twice differentiable function. Remember, the mean value theorem says that if f is continuous and differentiable, then there is a place where the slope of the secant line is equal to the slope of the tangent line. So you want to show this is your explanation right here, because we're using the mean value theorem. These are the conditions, and you've shown me that the secant line is equal to the tangent line. Okay, typically when there are endpoints, that's what you want to be thinking about, and you don't actually have a function to take the derivative of. Okay, part B. Okay, now we're talking about g. Show that the g prime of 2 is the same as g prime of 5. So this is g of x. Okay, I need to find the derivative. So first thing you should be doing is, let's take this derivative. This is where you have to use your chain rule. So the derivative g is the derivative of the outside, inside stays the same, times the derivative of the inside. Okay, I need to find g prime of 2. So let's start with that. So I'm going to plug in 2 everywhere there's an x. Let's see what happens. Okay, now, keep going. F of 2 is actually given in the original stem of the problem. They told me that f of 2 was 5, so I'm going to replace this with 5. And I have g prime of 2 is really the same as f prime of 5 times f prime of 2. Now, I don't have information about either of these, okay? So I'm going to leave it like this. But we're going to do the same thing and find g prime of 5. So again, we came up with the general rule right here, so let's plug in our values for x. F prime of f of 5 times f prime of 5. I know what f of 5 is. It's given in the original stem of the problem. It's telling me it's 2, so I'm going to replace that with 2. If I do that, notice that g prime of 5 is really f prime of 2 times f prime of 5, which is the same as what I got for g prime of 2. So that's how you're showing that they are the same. Okay, part C. Show that the second derivative is 0 for all values of x, and that the graph does not have a point of inflection. So it's talking about the second derivative. It's talking about points of inflection. So first step is we need to come up with the second derivative. Here is your first derivative from part B. So I'm going to need to use the product rule here. So you've got this piece times this piece right here. So I'm going to go ahead and use the product rule. So the second derivative is going to be, okay, the derivative of the first piece, which is this piece right here, we're going to go ahead and use the chain rule idea. So derivative of the outside times the inside. So the derivative first, don't forget chain rule, times the second, plus the derivative of the second, so the derivative of the second factor would be f double prime of x times the first. So this is my second derivative, okay? Now, what they're telling us is if the second derivative is going to be zero, then it means that this piece is zero right here, and this whole piece is zero right here. Notice then this whole thing becomes zero, this whole thing becomes zero, so really this also becomes zero. But notice that if the second derivative is zero, this will always be zero for all values of s. So there's no sign change going on anywhere because this is always zero. So no sign change on g double prime of x. So that's why there is no point of inflection. Okay, lastly, part D. They give you a function h of x, which is defined as f of x minus x, and they want you to explain why from some number between 2 to 5, there has to be a place where h of r is 0. So basically they're asking, is there a place where the y value is going to be 0? Okay? Again, the only points that we have information about are 2 and 5. So I'm going to find h of 2, which is really f of 2 minus 2. F of 2 is 5, that's given. So 5 minus 2 is 3. I'm going to do the same thing for 5. H of 5 would be f of 5 minus 5, using this. And again, f of 5 is given as 2. 2 minus 5 is negative 3. So if h of 2 is 3, h of 5 is negative 3, how can I prove that there is a place where the function h for some value r is going to be equal to 0? So this is your intermediate value theorem right here. Though, only way the intermediate value theorem can hold is if the function is continuous. And I know that h is some composition of f and just x values. So because h of x is a continuous function, and because h of 2 is 3, h of 5 is negative 3, intermediate value theorem says that it has to hit every single y value in between. So h of some value r has to be 0. So because of the intermediate value theorem, h of r has to be 0. And this is your supporting work. You show me that you found h of 2 and h of 3.